Let's talk about atomic structure using a carbon atom as an example. If you look at a periodic table, this is the type of entry that you would see for carbon. It has a big capital letter C, because that's its elemental symbol, and it has a whole number 6 somewhere in that box, as well as 12.0107 in the box. So we'll get to those numbers soon. Let's start off by listing the 3 subatomic particles that make up each atom. Starting with protons, then neutrons, and electrons. Physicists have actually discovered many more than 3 subatomic particles, but these are going to be the 3 that are most important to us. So to start drawing our carbon atom, we need to figure out how many protons it has. And to do that, we look at the entry in the periodic table and find the whole number, which is the atomic number here. And this number tells us the number of protons in every atom of carbon. So we have 6 protons that we're going to add to our carbon atom, and I'm just going to draw 6 little plus signs packed together to represent the center or the nucleus of our atom. So let's fill in this table. Protons are located in the nucleus and they have a positive charge. The next type of subatomic particle is the neutron. Neutrons are located in the nucleus with the protons, but they have a neutral charge. So we can draw those in our atom by just drawing little circles. And I am going to draw 6 of them to represent 6 neutrons, but it's important to remember that the number of neutrons that an atom contains can and does vary. So in our table, the last column is for variable or fixed. The number of protons is fixed. And what I mean by that is that every atom of carbon must have 6 protons in its nucleus. If we add a proton or if we take a proton away, that atom is no longer carbon. The number of neutrons in an atom can vary. So we'll say that the number of neutrons is variable. And in parentheses, I'm going to write the word isotope, because atoms of the same element that have different numbers of neutrons are called different isotopes of that element. So what we are going to draw here is carbon 12. Since it has 6 protons and 6 neutrons, we add 6 plus 6 to get 12. So that completes our nucleus. Now we need to add the electrons. Electrons are located in electron shells that orbit the nucleus. Electrons have a negative charge and their number can vary. When we assign locations for the electrons, we first put them in a small shell that is relatively close to the nucleus. And that first shell is very small, so it can only hold 2 electrons. We are going to give our carbon atom 6 electrons to match the number of protons. So I'm going to draw those first 2 as a small letter E with a negative sign, and then another one on the other side. And just make a note to remind us that that first shell can holds 2 electrons. But I said we were going to give our carbon atom 6 electrons, so we have to draw another shell outside of the first. This is a larger shell, and it can hold a maximum of 8 electrons. We only have 4 more to add, so I'll add those 4. And And it's important to keep in mind that even though it's convenient for us to draw electrons in fixed locations on electron shells, that electrons are always in motion. So imagine these electrons are zooming around the nucleus. They're not just sitting in one place. Okay, that is our atom of carbon. Protons and neutrons in the nucleus, and electrons orbiting around the nucleus in electron shells. Now, carbon only has two electron shells, but for larger atoms, you may need to add a third. I'll draw it as a dashed line here. And that third shell can also hold 8 electrons. It's important to remember the number of electrons that each shell can hold, because that's how we can determine whether an atom is stable or unstable. If we take our example of carbon, the outermost shell of the carbon atom can hold 8 electrons, but as is, it only contains 4. That means there are 4 vacancies in the outermost shell. Anytime an atom has vacancies in its outermost electron shell, we say that the atom is unstable and it is reactive, which means that it will participate in chemical bonds. If we take an example like helium, helium has an atomic number of 2, which means it has 2 protons in its nucleus, and it has 2 electrons orbiting the nucleus in that first and smallest shell. Now, helium only has 1 electron shell, and we already said that that electron shell can only ever hold 2 electrons, which means that helium has a full outer shell. That's important because it means that helium is stable as is, and it is unreactive, which means that helium will not participate in chemical bonds. Any atom, such as carbon, that has vacancies in its outer shell, it really wants those vacancies to be filled. So the way that that happens is through chemical bonds, and we'll talk about chemical bonds next.